Hello and welcome to Just One More Watch. 52 watches over the course of 12 months. That's quite a few, isn't it? I've talked about this on the channel before. Beginning of last year, I decided, what do I need to do to balance out the content as best I can? 3 videos a week, and I reckon that one bought, one borrowed, and one sponsored, on average, was the best way to keep things in check. Now that means buying 52 watches each year, one per week average. I was thinking about this last week and I thought, I wonder how close I got to that over the last 12 months, and I couldn't believe it. I added them up and it is bang on 52, though I probably forgot about a couple. Question today is, what did I buy and where are they now? Now, a lot of these I bought knowing that I was going to sell them, so don't be offended if I have reviewed something, recommended it, you've bought it and you find out that I've sold it. I would absolutely go broke if I had to keep all 52 of these and then do the same next year. Quite often I'll buy something, unbox, then review, then sell it, or I'll review it in Lumos, then sell it, etc, etc. So there's a kind of slush fund of money and you'll see the same big brands coming up over and over again. That's how I manage it. But some I buy with the best intentions at heart, the intentions to keep them long term, but it doesn't always work out that way. Let's have a look at all 52 watches and work out where they are now. Okay then, 52 watches. I've got a couple of pages of notes here today. I'm gonna start first of all with the last watch that I bought last year, that being the Seiko SKX 007J1. I unboxed it and then I made a video telling you why I bought yet another Seiko 007 and why I thought you should all buy one too. They're discontinued now, they're getting harder to find, and there was a bit of a lull in terms of pricing. Lovely watch, I bought a brand new Seiko Jubilee to go along with it, and it hasn't left the house. It's another one of the slightly odd Safe Jenny collection that I have in here. Maybe it will see some wrist time in 2022. Next up, it's the Steel Dive 1970, that featured in the same unboxing video as the SKX late last December. I then reviewed it in January, asking, was it the best of the 6105 homages? My answer was yes, if it's the cheapest. Kraken watch, but I bought the wrong one. Don't buy green or blue because they look a little odd. Buy black, I think. I'm gonna mod that one. Difficult to mod though because it's got a 4 o'clock crown and a 3 o'clock date. Leave that one with me, stay tuned. Moving on to one of my favorite watches of the year. You may well see this one again in my top 5, bottom 5 video, if you know what I mean. It's the Seiko King Turtle. A cracking looking watch, I think. Great value for money from Seiko, and with all of the upgrades we've been screaming for, those being ceramic bezel insert, sapphire crystal, and the hacking and hand winding forearm movement. I loved it, but I also sold it. I just picked up a King Samurai, that'll feature a bit later on. I'll keep this one brief, the Timex Allied Coastline. Was it better than the Casio Duro? No, it wasn't, so I sold it and kept my Duro. Now, this is an interesting one, the Orient King Diver. This one was on loan from a friend over in Melbourne, and I savaged it so badly in the first of the ongoing Sunday Roast series that I felt so bad I bought it off him. It's still in a drawer. I'm assembling an ugly 3-piece watch collection. I'm gonna do that as a bit of a comedy giveaway at some point in the future. So the Orient was the first Sunday Roast. The L'Oreal was the first of the Epic Dial typos for the year, and what a typo that one featured. It was, of course, the Eternal Classic Superlative Movementer, which was Sinosely Certified. No idea what they were thinking, but props to them for getting 4 spelling mistakes on the same dial. Oh, and in case you're wondering, I sold it to somebody on Marketplace. Third Seiko on the list, you can see a recurring pattern here, is the Seiko SNZG13, actually the second SNZG13 that I bought. I claimed it was the best value for money Seiko you can buy right now, and not much has happened since then to change my mind. $120, $130 for a handsome big watch. Okay, it's dated, but it does what it does very well if you're all right with the 7S26. I sold it, but I probably shouldn't. I may well end up buying another at some point in the future. Now at 8 and 9, it's a pair of micros that I bought. I did get a discount on them, but I bought a Feynman 1 and a Feynman Cove. I really like the Feynman design language. It is not gonna be for everybody, but I've still got both of those watches. I haven't flipped them. I know there were skeptics who thought they wouldn't last too long. The Cove's a really good looking dive watch. The 1, which is now all gone, sold out, is a gorgeous, very, very left field dress watch. They don't get a lot of wrist time, but they're both keepers. At number 10, it's the fourth Seiko already and the first of two appearances by the Sumo. I got this one at a cracking price earlier on this year. It's a great watch, the Sumo. Sapphire crystal, big, bulky, very, very purposeful, good looking thing as well, but I don't really have the wrist for it, unfortunately. So I sold that one and used the money to buy a Chrono Sumo that you'll be seeing in a minute or two. Next up, it's a Timex Expedition. I didn't buy it with the intention of savaging it, but it too became a Sunday roast. A big ugly lump of misshapen, miscolored plastic on my wrist. I couldn't wait to get rid of that one, and somebody bought it on Marketplace. At number 12, I still remember how excited I was to get the Aesop Tourbillon in from AliExpress. Aventurine dial Tourbillon for about $220 US. And I've still got it. I talked about this in the State of the Collection video, not sure quite what to do with it. Maybe I will try and daily a Tourbillon for a month next year and see how I go. First Casio on the list, and believe me, there are plenty more to follow. It's what I described as the real Casio Oak. Kraken looking model from the Edifice range, a whole bunch of features and sapphire crystal. It wore beautifully as well because it was super slim. Doesn't mean to say that I didn't sell it shortly after the review though. Which is a similar story for the Vostok 24 Hour. I actually bought this one from a subscriber in the States. I paid the postage, he pretty much gave it to me for nothing. He had bought it, didn't understand why he bought it. I reviewed it, didn't understand why I bought it from him, and I sold it on to somebody else who's probably scratching their head at this point in time as well. Yeah, okay, I get it, 24-hour military time, but unless every watch face and every clock in the world adopts this time, it's a hindrance rather than a help, in my humble opinion, of course. Casio number 2, it's the AE1300, the watch that I studiously ignored whilst wearing a pink t-shirt. Why did I ignore it? Well, it had all the same specs and the same price tag as the AE1200, but it was uglier. It got sold. Moving on to yet another Seiko and my big Seiko purchase for this year, the SPB185, the Steel Master, the Marine Master 200, whatever you want to call it. I reviewed one on loan earlier on in 2021 and I fell madly in love with it and I bought my own. But it's on a shaky nail at the moment. It's got a slightly misaligned bezel. I'm debating as to whether I get that fixed or just flip it and be done with it. Time will tell on that one. It's a shame because it is such a good looking watch. Next up, it's a Citizen, one of a number of Citizen watches featuring on the list from this point onwards. And on paper, this one offers heaps for the money. It's a GMT, it's got a world time bezel. It's eco-drive, meaning you never have to change the battery. 6 months charge if you leave it on a window ledge for a couple of days or so. I really quite liked it, but the hands were slightly all over the place and it was a bit big and chunky, so I sold it to buy more Citizens. At 18, 19, 20 and 21, it was my first and possibly my last foray into vintage watches. Why did I do it? I mean, why did I make that silly face on the thumbnail? I bought 4 retro pieces from my good friend Ashley over in Melbourne, those being a Langel, Certina, Doxa and Laco in that order. Cracking little watches, but a little bit hit or miss when they were on the time grapher, shall we say. Stay tuned, the Doxa is overseas getting repaired at the moment. I'll make a video about it when it gets back. I didn't sell any of them though, still got all 4. Next up is the second Casio Edifice, aka the Casio Aqua Terra. Kraken watch if you're looking for a cheap one watch collection, this one. $75 US or thereabouts. Okay, it's quartz, it's only got mineral crystal, but it is such a Kraken watch, wears beautifully as well. 2 different sizes, even for those with really small wrists. I didn't sell it, I've still got this one. Moving on to the next of the epic dial typos, it's a natural park that I paid $42 US for, purely to mock it. This was the one wound by 6 elves, apparently. So much irony, especially considering it was quartz. At number 24, it's a watch I bought knowing I was going to give it away again. It was the big Oris giveaway to celebrate 200,000 subscribers mid-year. That was won by a chap called Tony from the UK. He picked that stunning 41.5mm relief bezel ruby red dial Aquis. Good choice, Tony. I hope you're enjoying it. Next up, it's the first Timex on the list and my first foray into birth year watches, though not actually, because this one is a retro reissue of a watch from 1975. I know I don't look that old, do I? Believe it or not, I hung on to this gaudy little number in all its golden patent crocodile strap glory. An occasional wear, but a fun wear nonetheless. And it's another repeat this time with the Invicta 1953.5. I bought one when they first came out in 2020, and I bought another one in 2021. when they updated them with those bi-coloured bezels. I really like this watch. If you can pick one up for 99 bucks, I reckon it makes a strong case for itself, as long as you're okay with the fact that it says Invicta on the dial. Two for the price of one next, as I bought a whole bunch of parts from AliExpress to build my own watches. I built one of them really quite successfully. I thought that was a stunning piece for just over $100. It was the colour match date window that really set that one off. I also bought a bigger manual wind 6498 clone case. Haven't quite got around to that one yet. Stay tuned for that, I'm sure. We've had the automatic Seiko Sumo, I hinted at it earlier on. I then picked up the solar powered chrono version of the same watch, got this one for a steal, and made the case that you should be looking at this quite seriously rather than the auto. Don't look at it that closely though, because it's a little bit all over the place when it comes to the dial, chopped off indices, awkward date position, and those bizarre photovoltaic cells that you can quite clearly see on a Seiko. They haven't got that right. They don't do it as well as Citizen, in my opinion. It was still too big for me though, so it got sold. Yet another watch that I have bought multiple times, and why not? They're so cheap, you may as well. It's the Casio MRW200H. This time on a bracelet, I argued it was the best $30 beta that you can buy. I've had an orange one, a purple one, and now this white dial one. I have sold all three, but I'll probably end up buying a fourth. Another red hot deal I got a few months ago was the Citizen NY0085. This, I argued, was the cheapest Divers watch, as in ISO certified, that you could buy. Certainly the cheapest one I've ever seen. I got it for 199 Aussie dollars. That's about 150 USD. Haven't found anything that cheap, and I've still got it. Which is sadly more than I can say for the Casio Oceanus 5000, the $1,000 Casio that I deliberately blacked out on the thumbnail. I really wanted to love this watch, and I did. I really wanted to keep this watch, but I didn't. As soon as I unboxed it, I knew it was just a bit too small. So I sold it to my good friend Ashley. There's definitely a bit of back and forth between me and Ash, and I have every intention to buy an Oceanus 3000 model, first quarter 2022. You heard it here first. That one is just a couple of mil bigger. I think it'll suit that chrono style better than the 5000 did. One fun pickup was the Tactical Frog. Doc's a homage. I picked this one up from AliExpress towards the middle back end of the year. I compared it rather favorably to a Doxa, but I admit I bought the wrong watch. I should have bought the Seastern. That's what the second thumbnail is all about. The Tactical Frog was okay, but the Seastern did the whole Doxa homage thing better. I sold the Tactical Frog to another Sydney local who loves it. Ah, the Citizen Bullhead. It's not generally a good sign when you burst out laughing when you open the watch box, but that's the experience I had with the Citizen. I felt it was just comically small, actually smaller than the original watch from the late 1960s. It was okay, but a bit of a disappointment. That one got flipped in short order. Big Lebowski references abounded, or abided, in my review of the DW5900, a watch that I bought from my friend Ashley in Melbourne. I did say there was plenty of back and forth. He'd picked it up for himself. Wasn't all that comfortable reading the small digits on the dial. I said the same thing in the review, but I passed it on to somebody else on Marketplace who thought it was amazing. One watch I think is amazing is the Seiko Dress KX, and I bought a two-tone SRPE 60 again towards the back end of this year. Cracking watch, and one that I have worn quite a lot since then. Definitely one of Seiko's best releases over the last few years. I will probably end up modding this, at least with some sapphire. Let's see what I do to it over the course of 2022. Next up, it is the watch on my wrist today. Another watch that I have bought and sold and bought and sold and bought and sold and bought. It's the Oris Diver 65. I sold my bronze bezel in a panic last year when I bought a car, and I bought another one just about bang on 12 months later. I bought it used, paid 1700 Aussie, and it's just as gorgeous as the one that I sold was. I keep saying I'm not gonna sell the Oris 65, and I keep selling the Oris 65, so I'd be an idiot to make any promises about this one, wouldn't I? All right, next up, we've got a run of watches from AliExpress, not all of which have ended up getting reviewed on the channel. I buy a lot of stuff, but it doesn't make the cut, it doesn't make the grade, and it ends up in the drawer of shame. One watch that ended up in the drawer of shame was the Guan Chin, which was a shame because I had high hopes for it. Unfortunately, I ordered one with an NH35, and they sent me one with a Miyota 8215, so no review for that one. I did review the pair of escapement times that I bought mid-year though. That little Grand Seiko homage on the left there is a truly cracking little piece, and believe it or not, It's a quartz. It's one of those Seiko VH31s that ticks 4 times per second. You wouldn't see it to look at it. Somebody sent me an email shortly after the video asking if they could buy it on the blue leather strap that I had shown it on. So I said, all right. The Flieger I wasn't all that impressed with though. I thought it was big, bulky, didn't wear too well. Never reviewed it. It got sold. At number 41, it's an Adidas dive watch that I do highly rate. I just haven't quite got around to it. It's their Petit Prince homage, a small Flieger style watch on a metal bracelet, Seiko NH35 sapphire crystal, well under 100. Maybe I'll get onto that one first quarter. And at 42, it's a Duca, which was a duking disappointment. This is an IWC homage, and again, I got it in looking for that next killer $99 watch. This was not it, so it hasn't been featured on the channel. Buy the Guanxin, buy a Vostok, or buy a Steel Dive 70 instead. And at number 43, this was a bit of an odd experience. I think I'd had a few adult beverages when I ordered this one, and I ordered it because I thought it looked ridiculous and I was going to give it a roasting. It features a GMT bezel that is a 24-hour timing bezel, and it's not a GMT. Utterly pointless. When it arrived, I realised it was a fake Seiko. That's why it looked so odd. The store selling it on AliExpress had rubbed out the Seiko on the photographs. There's no way I'm going to review that one on the channel. The loom is amazing though. I might strip it down and turn it into something else at some point. Alright, we're getting close to the end now with watches I have reviewed in November and December. First up is the Seiko SRPG27, their new field watch. I double unboxed this one with the King Samurai that I hinted at earlier on, and then I declared it was the best field watch you could buy for $200, because I think it probably is. I've still got it. I'm going to compare it to another watch that I've got coming in the post this week. But at number 45, before then, I will be reviewing the King Samurai. I bought the King Turtle, loved it. Bought the King Samurai as well this year, unboxed it with the Seiko SRPG. I'm going to make a review of it, and then I'm going to compare it to another couple of Japanese heavyweights from Citizen and from Orient. I gotta say though, I don't like it as much as I like the King Turtle. At numbers 46, 47 and 48, it was the three watches that I bought for the Christmas giveaway, those being the Casio G-Shock 5600, the Orient Komatsu and Matchy Matchy SRPE60, the Dress KX two-tone, just like what I has. I posted them off today to a chap called David who lives down in Port Kembla, which is only about an hour and a half south of Sydney. I've got family down there. I could have dropped it off on a visit. Congratulations, David. Wear those ones in good health as well, and thanks to everybody who entered any and all of the competitions over the course of the year. Number 49, the Citizen Fugu. It was a case of Fugu you rather than Fugu me. A little bit disappointing. I didn't really see what this offered that I hadn't seen a dozen times elsewhere. This one might struggle against the Orient and the Seiko, then I'll be flipping it, no doubt, for a heavy loss. At number 50, arguably one of the biggest bargains of the year, and a year full of bargains, it's this Tribus. The budget watch community was buzzing about 6 weeks ago when Tribus, who are owned and operated by Christopher Ward and his three sons, decided to liquidate their stock, selling everything at 70% off. I got a Cost Chronometer Swiss made GMT landed for $606, which is a ridiculous price. Well, I say landed, it hasn't quite landed yet. It got stuck in Heathrow for about a fortnight, but I got the text the other day saying at least it has arrived in Sydney. If I can squeeze in a review before Christmas, I will. If not, you might see it in the new year. At number 51, when I made the review of the Seiko claiming it was the best field watch you could buy for under $200, one of the first comments said, "No, it isn't, the Orient Defender is." And I said, "All right, I'm gonna buy an Orient Defender and put the two of them head to head." It's still on its way from Singapore. You can expect to see that video at some point in the new year as well. It's already getting busy first quarter 2022, isn't it? And last but not least, the last watch that I bought this year, it arrived yesterday. It's a Casio Robocop, or at least that's what the subscriber said it was when he told me he'd picked one up for $10 from Walmart. I paid 50 Aussie for mine. It's gonna have a Robocop themed thumbnail. That may be the best part of the review. So there you have it, 52 watches, averaging one per year over the course of 12 months. What have I sold? What have I still got? Well, I reckon I've still got 28 of them, those being the SKX Steel Dive, the Garbage Orient, the two Feynmans, the Tourbillon, the SPB 185 Shaky Nail, four Vintages, the Casio Aquaterra, the Gold Timex, Build Your Own, both of them, the Citizen 085, the SRPE 62 Tone, the Oris It's still there, I just checked. And the Guan Chin disappointment, the Duca disappointment, the Addis Petty Prance, the fake Seiko, not sure what I'm going to do with that one. The SRP G27, the King Samurai, the Fugu, the Tribus, which isn't even here yet, and the Orient Defender, which isn't even here yet, and the disappointing Robocop. Yeah, 28, that's not bad. As I said, I would go broke if I kept them all, and I bought some with the intentions of flipping them. Did I sell the right watches? Did I buy the right watches? Leave me your comments. Let me know your thoughts on that. Thanks for watching this one. Why don't you check out another video while you're here? Watch me unbox that SPB185 and be disappointed by the bezel, or unbox the Casio and be disappointed by the fact that it's too small. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.